Welcome to the Building Faith Families podcast with Steve Demme. I'm your host, Scott Moore. Thanks for joining us today. Good morning, Steve. How are you?
I am still warm, even though it's cold outside, and I'm doing fine. How are you doing?
I'm warm because my wife keeps it really hot in the house.
So you get to pay the high heating bills.
Yeah, I lost that argument a long time ago.
Well, my daughter-in-law keeps it cold. I think their house is in the low 60s or mid to low, like 63 in the summer.
Yeah, I'd have a doghouse outside I was sleeping in if I tried that.
Yeah, I sleep in a tent too where it's warm. Okay, well, we're going to work on some more about the heart today and talk about the man who had a really good heart in the biblical sense. We use that expression a lot, somebody's got a good heart, and hopefully it's true, but we know for sure that David had a great heart. So let's pray. Father, thank you for your word that's so encouraging to us, and here we are thousands of years after David lived, and we're still being encouraged by his life. And I pray that you'll quicken our understanding today. Help us to see David with new eyes and understand what's on your heart as we read about this man that you loved and that you took from the sheepfolds and made him king. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
So we've done a whole series before on David, and I love the guy. But when we first meet David in the Bible, he's a humble shepherd boy taking care of the flock which belongs to his father Jesse. Saul was king of Israel, but as king, he disobeyed God's command and was rejected. 1 Samuel 13 says, Samuel said to Saul, "You have done foolishly. You have not kept the command of the Lord your God with which he commanded you. For then the Lord would have established your kingdom over Israel forever. But now your kingdom shall not continue. The Lord has sought out a man after his own heart, and the Lord has commanded him to be prince over his people, because you have not kept what the Lord commanded you." And it's an incredibly convicting scripture when you read those passages about Saul didn't follow the commands of the God to the letter and said that he did. Samuel said, "No, you didn't," and he was rejected. But notice that God sought out a man after his own heart. What a phrase. But this was a description of David. Apparently, he was a man whose heart was totally for God. He truly loved God with all his heart, soul, mind, and strength. In the 16th chapter of 1 Samuel, God directs Samuel to go to the house of Jesse and find and anoint the next king among his sons. He looked these men over, and though it must be one of the older brothers, for he was looking at their outward appearance, God had to remind him that he was looking at their heart. And so at God's direction, after meeting all of the impressive sons, Samuel anointed David to be the next king. Here's what he said. "The Lord said to Samuel, 'Do not look on his appearance or on the height of his stature, because I have rejected him. For the Lord sees not as man sees. Man looks on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart.'" So it's an inner thing. "And as David stood there among his brothers, Samuel took the flask of olive oil he had brought and anointed David with the oil. And the Spirit of the Lord came powerfully upon David from that day on." 1 Samuel 16:13. In God's eyes, our heart is what is most important, not how tall we are or our outward appearance. Moses also knew God. He had spent years in his presence. When speaking to the children of Israel, he mentioned this very concept, quote, "You shall remember the whole way that the Lord your God has led you these 40 years in the wilderness, that he might humble you, testing you to know what was in your heart, whether you would keep his commandments or not." Deuteronomy 8:2. Since God does not change, we're not surprised to hear God speak centuries later to King Asa in Chronicles through Hanani, the seer, about his heart. "The eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth to give strong support to those whose heart is blameless toward him." 2 Chronicles 16:9. Even in the Beatitudes, Jesus mentioned the heart. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Matthew 5:8. But our hearts are difficult to understand. One day we love God, and the next we have a hard, rebellious heart. Jeremiah has some sober words about the state of our natural heart. Quote, the human heart is the most deceitful of all things and desperately wicked. Who really knows how bad it is? But I, the Lord, search all hearts and examine secret motives. I give all people their due rewards according to what their actions deserve. It's in the 17th chapter, the 9th and 10th verses. Because of the importance of having a redeemed, teachable heart, which is devoted to God, we need to follow David's example and ask God to search our hearts. Psalm 51, Psalm 139 say, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Psalm 139, search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts. See if there be any way of pain or grievous way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. Many times I've been convicted about the condition of my heart by reading scripture. In fact, I was convicted just this morning reading something about 2 seconds ago. Examining secret motives. Wow. Okay, anyway, Hebrews 4:12 says, the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and of spirit, of joints and of marrow, and discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart. Another way to determine the spiritual condition of our heart is by what we say. For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. Our speech can be a window into our inner man. If our heart is soft and humble, then our words will be edifying and encouraging. But if we have a heart that is hard and feisty, we are more likely to say harsh and harmful words. What comes out of the mouth proceeds from the heart, and this defiles a person. For out of the heart come evil thoughts, murder, adultery, sexual immorality, theft, false witness, and slander. That's Matthew 15. Perhaps this is why David prayed, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. As the heart goes, so follows the tongue. No one likes hypocrisy. We don't like it when people's walk is not consistent with their talk. Jesus quickly saw through people who pretended to be godly with their words, but their behavior was not from their heart. This people honors me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. Matthew 15:8. God saw the same inconsistency when he spoke through Isaiah. These people say they are mine. They honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. And their worship of me is nothing but man-made rules learned by rote. Because of this, I will once again astound these hypocrites with amazing wonders. Isaiah 29. Now, some of these verses we have studied are sobering, while others are encouraging. I hope you will be determined to have a heart like David and be diligent in keeping your heart soft and teachable. Perhaps your parents have been praying for you like David prayed for his son Solomon. Notice his emphasis on the heart. This is found in 1 Chronicles 29. I know, my God, that you test the heart and have pleasure in uprightness. In the uprightness of my heart, I have freely offered all these things. This was building materials for the temple. And now I have seen your people who are present here freely offering and joyously to you, O Lord, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, our fathers. Keep forever such purposes and thoughts in the hearts of your people and direct their hearts toward you. Grant to Solomon, my son, a whole heart, that he may keep your commandments, your testimonies, and your statutes, performing all, and that he may build the palace for which I have made provision. And here's two closing passages that I hope will encourage you as much as they've encouraged me. Jeremiah 31, this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, declares the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts. And I will be their God, and they shall be my people. And here's a prayer that I often pray for myself and my family. It's found in Deuteronomy 30, verse 6. The Lord your God will circumcise your heart and the heart of your offspring, so that you will love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul, that you may live. Amen. Okay, Brother Scott, did those words touch your heart?
Indeed. I'm continually stunned at how important the heart is when you read Scripture. I mean, there's literally the condition of your heart seems to be the most important thing about us. I mean, when you lose heart, you lose your ability to accept God's truth. I mean, people failed in battle because they lost heart. It says that about Saul in Samuel. And David said when he was going up against Goliath, let no one lose heart on account of this Philistine.
Well, that's good.
And then it's everywhere. Throughout. I mean, I just put it in the Bible Gateway thing. I just put in the word heart. There's like 725 mentions of the word heart.
Yeah.
And you go through them, I mean, some of them don't necessarily apply in this manner, but most of them are about the condition of our very being. And when it says the heart is deceitful, like, man, that's brutal. And when my heart gets deceitful, it takes me out of everything that God wants for me,
Well, the next episode, we're going to talk about my first experience where I learned about the importance of the heart. But it is. It's what sets us apart. And it's amazing because it's very difficult to put your finger on the heart. I think that's why I put these passages in here about how to discern our heart by our tongue, or where your treasure is, there will your heart be. Another similar passage. Or David's prayers, because even though he had a great heart, he continued to do maintenance, you might say. He continued to seek God to search his heart and give him a pleasing heart and create a new heart within him. So these are prayers that he prayed regularly, apparently, and they worked. So that's the encouraging part.
Yeah, I think we should follow suit.
Absolutely. I've learned, and I don't know what people hear when I say soft heart or fleshly heart, but there's a difference. I know when I have a hard heart. It's almost like when my heart is hard, I'm just not able to hear God. I'm not, the word of God doesn't come to life. And when my heart is soft and pliable, I'm in a much better position to be led by the Spirit and connect with God. And so, yeah, I've done lots of praying about my heart, and may God continue to give us humble, teachable hearts. There's a place in John where it says, the 8th chapter, he says, my word did not have free course in you. He was talking to the people that were trying to tell him he was of the devil and all that. And I've often done a mental picture of God's word kind of rattling around in me. And if I have a soft heart, it will receive what God is saying. But if I have a hard heart, it just bounces off because it's not able to take in what God is talking to me. So, and I really was convicted just today as I was reading through this. That's one of the blessings. I get so much good putting these together. It says, I was using a different translation, and it says, I, the Lord, search all hearts and examine secret motives. Whew. Because, sometimes we do the right thing, but we have the wrong motivation. And sometimes we do the wrong thing with the right motivation, and wow, we've got to let God sort it out. But we've got to do our part in asking God to give us a fresh heart and a clean heart on a regular basis.
Well, and getting in tune with your heart. I mean, I think there's plenty of times in my life when I'm not even paying attention to the condition of my heart. And it's really critical to know the condition of your heart and pay attention to that. You'll just go your own way if you're not paying attention to it. And it's also immensely helpful if you can notice it in others. I mean, if my wife notices that my heart's getting hardened and can point that out when I'm not paying attention to it, that can bring me back, And it's really, I don't know if there's anything else more important than this.
Yep. Amen. Well, let's pray and ask God for a soft heart right now in closing. Father, thank you that you search our hearts, but thank you that you have also provided a remedy for our hearts. And I pray that you'll take the stony stuff out of our hearts and give us Davidic hearts, hearts that love you, want to glorify you, want to follow you. Give us a heart like David had, and give us the wherewithal to continue to pray these prayers so that we continue to have our hearts lined up with your heart. And I believe this is according to your will, because you've taught us and commanded us to love you with all our heart. Help us to have the hearts that please you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. And that's our show for this week, folks. Thanks for joining us for the Building Faith Families podcast with Steve Demme. If you have a question for the show, email Steve at spdemme@gmail.com. If you have a question for me, you can reach me at Scott@unsocializedmedia.com. Thanks for joining us. Have a great week.